in a series that we have been organizing here with the cooperation and collaboration of the two. And since Raza Sahab cannot possibly travel, the Secretary of the Academy, Khalid Bashir Ahmed, is here. He'll do the honors. So may I request Mr. Khalid Bashir Ahmed to come over and do the honors.
Janab S.H. Raza, Janab Ashok Bajpai Ji, friends in the Raza Foundation, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. I feel privileged in standing before this august gathering to perform the duty of honoring the celebrated artist, Janab S.H. Raza, for his pioneering contribution to the development of modern art in Jammu and Kashmir. I am doing this pleasant duty on behalf of the Honorable Chief Minister, Janab Umar Abdullah, who was to come here and personally do the honor. But due to the last minute pressing engagement, he had to cancel his visit and he directed me to do this honor for him. The J&K Academy of Art, Culture and Languages, of which the Chief Minister is the President, will today present a memento, a shawl, and a citation to Mr. Raza as a token of respect for and recognition of his outstanding work for the promotion of fine art in Jammu and Kashmir. Before I read out the citation, a quick word about the J&K Academy of Art, Culture, and Languages. The Academy was set up in the year 1958 under the proviso of Constitution of Jammu and Kashmir to actively work for preservation, development, and promotion of art and literature and revitalizing rich cultural traditions within the state. Honorable Governor of Jammu and Kashmir is the patron of the Academy. The Academy combines in itself Kala, Sangeet and Sahitya and annually awards creative works in these fields besides doing an ambitious publication program in as many as 9 languages. It's a matter of pride for us that during the past over 5 decades, eminent personalities in the fields of art and literature have been associated with the activities of the Academy. Take for instance, the holding of annual All India Urdu Mushairas in Kashmir. The Academy has the distinction of hosting poetic geniuses like Pirag Gorakhpuri, Jigar Murad Abadi, Vamik Jonpuri, Ali Sardar Jafri, Shahryar, and others. Likewise, in the fine arts category, celebrated artists including M.F. Hussain, S.N. Bendre, Lakshman Pai, Jatin Das, and G.R. Santosh, to name a few, have attended the painting camps organized by the Academy over the years. Their paintings are our treasured collection. That was briefly about the Academy, and now, with your permission, I will read out the citation signed by the President Academy, the Honorable Chief Minister of Jammu and Kashmir, and present it along with a memento and a Kashmiri shawl to Janab S.H. Raza. Born in 1922 at Babariya, Madhya Pradesh, Saeed Haider Raza graduated from Sir J.J. School of Arts in 1943 and became one of the founder members of the Progressive Artists Group in 1947. Through his work, he rose to become a distinguished artist and earned international repute. Over the years, he was conferred with many awards, including the coveted Padma Shri and Padma Bhushan by Government of India in the field of visual art. He is also recipient of Lalit Kala Ratna Award, Kalidas Samman, Prix de la Critique, Paris, Dayavati Modi Award, and Rajakiya Samman by Government of Madhya Pradesh, as well as Fellowship of Lalit Kala Academy. Raza Sahab has had a special relationship with Kashmir. He came to Srinagar in 1948 and inspired modern art movement that resulted in art activities getting a fillip in Kashmir. The first solo exhibition of his paintings was held at Srinagar in 1948. Young and budding artists of Kashmir came in contact with him and were introduced to the trends in modern art around the world. Some of these artists themselves became names to reckon with in art circles of the country. He was instrumental in bringing to limelight at national level several artists of Kashmir, some of whom held exhibition of their works at Bombay those days, the first ever by Kashmiri artists outside Jammu and Kashmir. Raza Saab is the person behind the first painting exhibition held in Srinagar in June 1948, which was visited by hundreds of people, including some from rural areas. That was unprecedented in those days of Kashmir. He inspired the setting up of the first organization of artists in Kashmir, named the Progressive Artists Association, and attended its maiden meeting at Srinagar. He was specially allowed by Janab Sheikh Mohammed Abdullah to travel through Kashmir, during which he did on-the-spot paintings. He stayed in Kashmir for about 4 months and left only after he had ensured that the sapling of modern art in Kashmir had taken firm roots. It was in Kashmir that famous photographer Henri Cartier-Bresson advised him to concentrate on construction of painting and study Cezanne, that landed him in France, where his life and art took a major turn. Jammu and Kashmir Academy of Art, Culture and Languages, in recognition of his pioneering work in the development of fine art in Jammu and Kashmir, presents this citation to Janab S.H. Raza, signed by Chief Minister Omar Abdullah.
Public institutions and art. Arts need institutions. In any field, you need a series of institutions. For music, you need concert halls. For theater, you need performing spaces. For visual arts, you need galleries. For literature, you need publishers. So there is an institutional aspect of the arts. The arts cannot possibly sustain and survive without the institutional framework. Now, some of these institutions are made publicly. That is, they are made by governments, funded by governments, run by governments, with varying degrees of autonomy, independence, choices, etc. And there are other institutions which are made by private individuals, but have a public charter. Raza Foundation itself is an example, which is a public institution created by an artist. There are some who you will be speaking this evening, Mr. Suresh Nevatia and Mr. O.P. Jain, who are industrialists. They are not artists per se. They have been vulnerable to the arts and have created institutions from their own resources, which are public institutions. And there are institutions which have been created by government, funded by the National Gallery of Modern Art, the Three Academies, the Crafts Museum, etc., etc. And time has come, but the time has been coming for a long while, I thought. But anyway, when we should start having a hard look, because it can be argued with some degree of confidence that our public institutions are in varying degrees of decline. They have resources, physical and financial, but they don't have visions, dynamism to make themselves relevant to what is happening in the arts today. We have had a series of reviews, commissions have been appointed, and the last one about the scene National Academies was the famous Huxer Commission, which went around the country, recorded evidence of 1,000 people, and came out with a series of suggestions and things of that kind. Today, one can almost say that the three national academies are more or less, with varying degrees, irrelevant to what is happening in the world of arts. They are not vulnerable to innovation, they are not vulnerable to innovative darings, they are not open to new ideas, etc., etc. And then there are problems of inheritance, there are people who make a difference and they go away, there's lack of professionalization, this, that, and the other. And you have private institutions created by public zeal of people who also suffer from similar problems, perhaps. There's a person who creates an institution, and while he's there, the institution thrives. And if he's not there, or she's not there, and the very few institutions in the so-called private domain which have done very well. But at the moment, it seems to be that the private institution, by which I mean public institution created by private initiative, seem to be doing exceedingly better than the public institution. There is a crisis. In a welfare democratic system, it is the duty of the state to promote culture. But it is also the duty of the state not to do so with any ideological axe to grind. It is to allow. Now, the autonomy in some of the national institutions has become autonomy of the bureaucracy, which occupies them. So the autonomy is almost unaccountability. You can do whatever you like, or you may not do whatever you like, and you are not accountable. So there is a crisis, and we thought we should devote some time, and we have four eminent people. Two of them, Mr. Suresh Nevatia and O.P. Jain, are some of the very few people who have taken to promoting culture, although it was not their job to do so. I mean, they are not sort of professionally required or obliged to do so, but they have done so. Suresh Nevatia by creating Jnanaprabha in Banaras, and what he has been doing in Calcutta for a long while, and then also in Bombay. And there's O.P. Jain, who created the very legendary Sanskriti Kendra. And we have two other experts who have worked in these public institutions. Yotindra Jain in the Crafts Museum, and Kalyan Chakravarti in the IGNCA, and before that, the Museum of Man, the National Museum of Man. So we have a mix of people who bring different insights. So may I invite my panelists to first come and occupy the space. Mr. Nevatia, Mr. O.P. Jain, Mr. Jyotin Jain, Kalyan Chakravarti. There's spaces, your names are indicated, so you might like to seat yourself there. The rule of the game, quite simply, is that all these venerable figures will speak for 10 to 12 minutes each, and then they might speak to each other if they have to seek clarification or raise curiosities about each other, and then it will be open to the House for questions and such other comments as you may like to make. So there you are. You have, why I'm sitting in the middle, but anyway. Let's not labor the obvious for too long. Yes, it is acknowledged that we are in a crisis. Yes, it is clear that the public institutions are in decline. It's also clear that perhaps governments are withdrawing in varying degrees from support to this area, which in any case has been rather adversarial in its role vis-a-vis the state. But should this happen? Should the professionalization another issue? So there will be insights brought to you. And may I request first Jyotindra Jain to start, and then we will take it from there. Oh, but before that, may I present you with flowers? I keep on forgetting, although they're sitting right there. Yes.
You can speak from wherever you are.
Ashok ji, fellow panelists, friends, the whole subject of cultural state of cultural institutions in India is so wide. It has such a checkered history. The problems are insurmountable and complex. So the question is, where do you begin and where do you end? To me, it appears that we are going to, all of us most probably, and sorry to preempt, maybe that may not happen with other panelists, but we are going to state problems. And these problems have appeared here and there in discussions, in newspapers, this, that, everywhere. So nothing new is expected to come out of with regard to the fate and situation of cultural or art institutions in this country. Nevertheless, I would reiterate some of that, and I'll talk about what I think from my experience of working, both being deeply connected with private institutions as well as government institutions, where I have generally worked for about 20 years or so, and therefore as an insider of public institutions and outsider in the sense having worked with private institutions. So I'll take about 10 minutes and I'll raise 5 points, and hopefully that will trigger discussion with other panelists. As we discuss the state of our art institutions, let us take cognizance of the fact that more than 90% of the cultural property of this country is under government control through the state-run museums, because mainly all our sculpture, painting, you know, in different museums, state-run meaning Government of India as well as the states, the Archaeological Survey of India, which has the control over majority of archaeological sites, and also state government archaeology departments, and various laws such as the antiquity law, which also controls various aspects of possessing, buying, trafficking in antiquity, etc., and which has influence in building institutions. The complete financing of these institutions comes from the state, and the appointment of the professional staff is also government controlled. So we have public service commissions and various bodies through which appointments are made. So when I say 90% of cultural property in India is under government control, roughly I mentioned this, there might be more things. We all know that the state of our museums and art institutions is pathetic. As I promised you, that we all know this and we're going to talk about it. Pathetic and deteriorating by the day. Our public museums are suffering from the most unimaginative curatorial ideas. More an ad hoc assemblage of objects than a coherent thematic narrative. You go to generally museums, you will find that objects are put. There is not particular narrative in that. You know, a very broad frame, chronological, these, that, Gupta period, Maurya period, that whole old periodization thing in which we assemble objects, you know, and we put them. There's no great narrative about it, no great theme. So they are just lying there, you know, a little better than a godown. A coherent thematic narrative. The lack of professional gallery information, the unattractive display and lighting, the unwelcoming attitude towards the visitor, the negligence of the collections in terms of the of conservation and preservation of art objects, the complete lack of scientific documentation of art objects. It is amazing that in 60 years, not one museum can claim that all their collections are digitized, they're put together, things, they're described and things like that. With the coming of digital technology, it should have been possible very quickly. But somehow it didn't happen. The near absence of research and publications. The National Museum has not published one comprehensive catalog of its collections or sectional catalogs in over 60 years. The frightening situation is the security of the collections, etc., of the museums. Thirdly, when even the housekeeping is in such a state, as I described, we cannot even come nearer the more theoretical discourse around the issues of role and histories of collecting and museumizing. All over the world, the academia and the museum, they have a dialogue. The academia is talking about the whole idea of museum. Is museum today at all valid? Do we want a museum? What does a museum do? You know, this German word is museal, meaning kind of deadly. So we keep this thing. So we will never come to discussing those issues. Comparative histories of collecting in India and Europe. What is this whole thing of collecting? What is that big power that museum has? It defines this is good art, this is bad art. This will never come to because good housekeeping we have not yet managed, you know. So around the issues of role and histories of collecting and museumizing, the museum's temple-like behavior with all its determining and legitimizing powers. The museum has legitimizing powers, decide what is good, what is bad, this is a masterpiece, this is not a masterpiece, tribal art is lower, classical art is higher, tribal class, all sorts of things, this categorization, all museums, you know, do. We will not come down to discussing all this, you know, because we are good housekeeping also, housekeeping we have not come out of it. Legitimizing powers, museums acting as supreme measure of cultural and aesthetic values, and the politics of what is art and what is not, and what to show and what to eclipse from the public eye. The museum decides what is a masterpiece and what is a minor art. Fourthly, what is plaguing the public art institutions? Funding? No. A mere excuse. How much unspent funds are left over at the end of the of each financial years? And when we do in government these revised estimates, and funds are available. I've worked with several institutions, including Indira Gandhi National Center for the Arts, where every year at least 10 to 15 lakhs or 20 lakhs were returned, despite what. So it's not enough that you have money. You have to work for doing good work, and you have to put up good event, which we don't. So we used to blame funding some years ago, when perhaps it was true. But today funding is not a problem. It's an excuse. Is the lack of competent, qualified and committed staff plaguing the museums? Yes. As an insider with more than 20 years of public museum experience, I have noticed repeated instances of mediocre persons getting selected to run art institutions, partly due to misguided choices on the part of the appointing authority, because the appointing authority may not be able to judge, because often the appointing authorities come from various fields and for various reasons sit in chairs where they should not sit, perhaps, or due to interference of the powers that be. So many appointments I have seen being made through this kind of things, you know, and then they sit there for a lifetime. And this is my own experience, and I'm talking from my 20 years of experience here. Now, there's this whole question of bureaucrats, you know, much maligned. Often they had to take over because something else was not available. But why something else is not available? Why have we brought the things down to that level that we kill the entire scene? And therefore, obviously, if there is nothing available, bureaucrats would come. Bureaucrats replacing professionals as heads of institutions is a major damaging factor. This situation has arisen because the practice of government departments running cultural institutions has gradually killed the development of professional cadres. You know, because a top man, if you bring from the bureaucracy or from the ministry, the second, the third, and fourth, they lose interest. They don't, you know, and when bureaucrats come, they come as a kind of first aid, but as a result, you know, then they go elsewhere. So there isn't a kind of continuity in institutions to develop cadres, etc. is one of the factors killed in the development of professional cadres. It is not true that in this country of thousands of qualified art practitioners and professionals, we cannot find the right directors to head our art institutions, so that bureaucrats have to hold extra charge. It's a very typical government term, extra charge, and then usurp the position of heads of these institutions. Very little effort is made to change the rigid and outdated recruitment rules, which keeps the number of qualified professionals out of the selection process, clearing the space for bureaucrats to take over. Why should this have happened? Bureaucrats have to take over because there is nothing available. But why should this have happened? Why have the things come down to that state? Many a brilliant professional, and suppose it has happened, even so, there are other possibilities to improve our institutions, even if a bureaucrat is running. Many a brilliant professional from outside may not seek a government job. Krishan Khanna, you won't take a government job, but if you are asked to come and advise, you would, perhaps. Yeah, so I'm saying that there is an intellectual capital available. So would be willing to advise, create, make intellectual inputs, guide the staff, document the collections, conceptualize exhibition policies, conserve art objects, write catalogs. Now, can't an outsider come and write a catalog in 60 years? Catalog and curate conferences. Can't we invite somebody from outside to curate? Everything has to be in-house, even if it is mediocre. Very rarely do any of our national cultural institutions invite outside curators to curate exhibitions. Why is there so? No system of regularly involving these outside professionals in the running of our institutions. Is the civil society an enemy? The early conceptual planning of art institution in the first 2 5-year plans fragmented the general fragmented the genre and practices of art in India. In the early planning exercises, first 2 5-year plans I'm talking about, planning exercises, all these so-called classical arts as well as the modern and contemporary art practices got placed within the Ministry of Human Resource Development and later on culture. While the folk and tribal arts, crafts came under the purview of the commercial ministries of industry and commerce. As the classical and modern arts became culture and the folk arts became commerce, their entire development as well as the intellectual discourse around them adopted different strategies, marginalizing the entire creative potential of tribal and village communities as commerce and commodity. This is because right in the beginning we did that. And how is it that the Lalit Kala Academy, now that was also planned in the first 5-year plan, how is it that the Lalit Kala Academy is nearly completely hijacked by modern art activity, whereas none of the 13 objectives, if you want a copy, none of the 13 objectives
of the Lalit Kala Academy specify this heavy emphasis on modern art. Good to know that modern and contemporary art is now Lalit Kala. Because originally, it was dealing with ancient art. There was Lalit Kala, ancient, edited by Karl Khandelwal, where other things were happening. Now, over the last two decades, or at least one and a half decade, it's only contemporary modern art. But in the very first five-year plan, National Gallery of Modern Art was created for modern art. And I'm I connect with modern art more than anything else. So it's not that I'm talking against modern, but I'm saying that what happened to institution along the line, there is one objective doesn't mention that it was meant for modern and contemporary art gallery. Okay, with regard to last two lines, with regard to private art institutions, Srinivati and Sri O.P. Jain will speak, but I would like to draw attention to a couple of points. Private cultural institutions seem to be a major alternative left for our arts. So difficult, because there would be antiquity law, there will be many other things for private institutions to come up on such a major way. However, one problem I see broadly, and this is not particularly to a particular individual or something, it is discouraging that this patronage is largely family run rather than professionalized. And I'm not saying that the family which contributes should not be a part of it, but running of day to day, I think less and less I see that it is not professionalized enough. That is, the family itself run, family members run, and then why are we critical of bureaucrats? In the sense that if it has to be both cases, it has to be professionally run. This can be discussed because we have people talking about that. And lastly, a major hurdle in the development of private museums of ancient and medieval Indian art is the antiquity law. This also needs to be discussed. So these are a few points that I have to make, and we'll discuss more as we proceed. Thank you so much.
Thank you. And now, never
hear. As to all those who are present, I find myself daunted to speak in the presence of such distinguished people. Pujya Kapila ji is also here, so I seek your blessing. I want to address the issue in a different way. Professor Jyotin Jain has spoken to you about the ailments which is afflicting the institutions, building of institutions, preservation of art, promotion of art. My personal feeling is that if we examine what is the relevance of art in human life, and if art enriches our heart and mind, then it is art. If it touches us, it is art. And if it doesn't touch us, it is not art. Now, the problem today is that there is a complete lack of awareness about art. Today, I live in a society in Delhi. When people talk about art, they talk of values. That this canvas is worth X amount of money. This is, I have got a Raza. I have got a Kishan Khanna. So it somehow, nobody wants to interpret as to what the artist wanted to convey and what was the thought in the art. Mind of the artist when he made that painting. Today, in schools and colleges, there is nothing about art which is a part of the curriculum. There is no awareness. People will not visit museums. You can't force them to visit. They have to be inspired to visit. And there is no inspiration. NGMA or National Museum, which is the treasure house, you go, the galleries are empty. It's not only because of the upkeep, because of the lack of display, because of the lighting, but nobody is interested. I recall the days. I'm not a scholar. I am not even, I have no credentials to my credit. But I recall my days when I used to sit around in 60s with great scholars, Rai Krishnadasji, Dr. Moti Chand, Karl Khandalawala, Vasudev Sharanji Agrawal, and my own uncle Gopikrishna Kanodia. And there was a continuous exchange of dialogue, and the way they used to interpret the sculptures and paintings. And there were foreign scholars who came, like Stella Kramish, and so many others who used to enrich that dialogue. There used to be a continuous exchange of ideas. Somehow, I mean, again, I have been, Mr. Johar Sarkar is here. He was kind enough to allow me to address the issue on Antiquities Act. Antiquities Act, it is the single biggest disaster that has happened to antiquity. The objective was laudable, but the result was just the opposite. It wanted to curb smuggling, and I am personally convinced, and I am aware, that pursuant to the enactment of the Act, the most important pieces of antiquity went abroad, because it all went underground. There were great collectors. I was a very small collector, like B.K. Birla, Jagdish Goenka, Gopikrishna Kanodia, Bombay, Jagdish Mittal. So many were there. No, Boman Bahram. They all stopped. There was a complete stoppage of acquiring Indian antiquity post 1976. What happened? The dealers took the objects underground. The lesser pieces were left in India, and the greater pieces left abroad, went abroad. Now this is, he put me on a committee. I am thankful to him. I was the lone dissenting voice for modifying that Antiquity Act. It had never seen the, there were no end result of that committee. We had many deliberations. He hosted a seminar. We all addressed, the minister was there. That's where it ends. Now, coming to institutions. Professor Jain has narrated all the ills, so I don't want to dwell upon that. My point is, even if you improve the upkeep, even if you improve everything, how do you manage? The whole interest of scholars has waned. Nobody is studying. How many scholars do we have? How many keepers we have of different sections? How the government can find anyone? It's not a question of salary. Even if you improve the upkeep, who will publish a catalogue? There are no scholars there. So scholarship has ended. And if they, you see, after all, sir, you are a great artist. Kishan Khanna Sahib is a great artist. But unless there is a scholarship to write what you are what you have written, what you have done, what you have painted, there is no scholarship. There are no curators. Curators are the galleries who are selling, but there are no independent curators. So the problem today is that how do we create department, how do we create awareness among the people to appreciate art? Everybody may not have the means to acquire art, but everybody should have a desire to go and see art. Unless we have that, just building institutions is not possible without public interest. You can't build institutions if the public is not interested. I want to address the issue in that way. And when we talk of private institution, mine is Gyan Prabha, my sister-in-law Bimla Poddar. She settled down in Banaras. And we had Professor R.C. Sharma, who retired as Director General of National Museum. He kindly agreed to join Gyan Prabha. He was an honorary acharya. He took upon himself whatever little collection I had, I gave it to Gyan Prabha. It is on public view. And Professor Jyotindra Jain said very correctly, that it's a family run. But the point is, at least we have tried to find an independent 2-3 trustees who are in Banaras. Now I can't shift Gyan Prabha from Banaras to Delhi. And it's not very easy for people in Banaras, for me to find people in Banaras who are interested, whether professionally or otherwise, to be there, to look after, promote, write about it, publish catalog, do some research. But we are trying our best, but we were able, lucky, that we found two eminent people as our trustees. And we have requested them that you are our custodians. We don't know. They are younger than us. We don't have a family. But we hope they will find, they'll do something, and they will run it. But infinitely, I have no idea what it will happen, because these institutions are fragile in terms of its longevity. And they are, so I can't foresee what can happen. And rightly, government institutions are immortal to the extent that they are going to be around. But private institutions' longevity shall always remain in doubt, except Birla Academy in Calcutta, which houses both antiquity and contemporary modern art. A very sizable collection is there, because that was set up by Birla in 70. So my request or my suggestion is that this August gathering should address their concern on the lack of awareness among the people. It should not be a rich man's game. It has to be a part of the curriculum, and people have to be made aware that there is a relevance of art in their life. If it is not relevant, it has no meaning. And government can't spend money if it is not relevant to the people. So that relevance of art in human life has to be created. And then only, and you see, sir, with all due humility, and Mr. Sarkar should not think, government has a department of culture. It doesn't have the passion for culture. So if it is a department, it will run like a department. Mr. Johar Sarkar possibly was the most apt secretary culture that came to the chair after many years. But he retired. Had he been there another 5-10 years, perhaps something would have happened. But the problem is, government secretary has to retire on a particular day. Maturity date is predetermined. So there is no continuity. Same way, why there is no director general in National Museum or directors in museum? Because there is no substitute. In secretary, they find the substitute good, bad or indifferent. But in National Museum and museums, how do you find keepers? They close the section when the keeper goes. That's what happens. But my humble submission is that there should be a large-scale attempt, that colleges, schools, there should be an awareness of art. Only when people want to learn, that there will be teachers. You can't have teachers and then the people. There has to be a need for the people to learn. Then there will be scholars. So it's a catch-22 situation, it's a chicken and egg story. So with these words, I thank all of you, and seek forgiveness if I have erred somewhere. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Last year, Raza Foundation had proposed to the Vice Chancellor of Delhi University that we will offer a course of 20 lectures to students, and we'll bring artists and art critics to speak to students and tell them about what art is all about. And the Vice Chancellor agreed, and he appointed a person to coordinate. And that lady, no, the Vice Chancellor did not change. He remains there, although he's become increasingly more controversial. But the lady who was in charge showed no interest and raised questions which were difficult for us to handle. He said, look, we'll take care of these 20 speakers. We will arrange for their transport and this, that. You just give us a room and enroll students who would like to come to this 1.5 hour lecture, which is totally an awareness program. Mm-hmm. And the
response. That's what I'm saying.
Anyway, Mr. Om Prakash Jain.
Well, friends, I stand here as Jyoti's explained that from the private sector, so we have made some attempts to do something which we liked. In fact, it was not for the reason that art is important or social work is important or dance is important, music is important. But when a private initiative happens, you know, it's primarily because you want to do that. Why it happens, it may be different reasons. In my case, it was a provocation by Dr. Mulkaraj Anand that I was able to proceed in that process. And many questions, in fact, Jyotin rightly said that for the last 40 years, almost 30 years, definitely. And now, with the change in the whole scenario, art scenario, and the volumes, when we started getting into art and cultural thing, I've heard Pandit Ravi Shankar singing in, with 20 people around Gandhar Mahavidyalaya. We started Sanskriti Awards in 1979, and the award money was 5,000 rupees, and the Muraji Sai, who was the Prime Minister of this country, came to deliver the award, first Sanskriti Award in 79. Skills were different, things were different. There was a connectivity between the person who creates art, the person who appreciates it, the person who sponsors it, who supports it. Now that connection is lost. Primarily the decay in the government sector particularly has been, in my opinion, because of the fact that earlier the prime ministers of this country, or people those who are running the country, they always had some people around them, those who were best in the field. And they were there, they were not advisors to the academies, but they were more or less not directly appointed advisors, but they used to listen to them. They had access to them, and they could meet them without any appointment. And prime ministers and the people who will take the decision will listen to them. We can think of people like Kamla Devi Chattopadhyay and Mulkaraj Anand, who could walk into prime minister's house every day. We talk almost on every, whenever he was in Delhi. He spent time with Sharda Prasadji, with many people, those who were with the prime ministers and other Jawaharlal Ji. He was the first president of Medical Academy. They used to, they had the authority even to tell the prime minister, he said, this is not fair, this is not good, you can't do this, this is not done. This kind of thing. Now that buffer, the people, those who were, there was a connectivity between the highest of the this thing and down the line, that is lost. After that, nobody could rise to that occasion, or particularly, I'm sorry to say, but after 75, it became like that you are a friend or you are an enemy. The whole country suffered on account of that phenomena of emergency, when this whole scenario in every field was divided, that either you are a friend or you are an enemy. As far as the institution is concerned, I personally feel whether it's a government institution or a private institution, we need, and whosoever established it, whether it was established by Maharaja of Jodhpur, like Mehrangarh Museum, whether it was established by the government of India, like a National Museum and many others, whether it is established by some individuals in Bombay, for example, Bhavdi Lal Museum and many others, or our own, my own institution, Sanskriti, which I am correcting. You need, Jyotinder has rightly said, that if a family establishes an institution, they have to be around, of course, to ensure that it's done properly, because if they are the people, those who have thought of it, and their passion, as long as they have got passion, they should be there. But it should always be run by professionals. What happened was, actually, I will tell you an interesting story. I had some nasal surgery. And Jyotinder will know when I tell you, because, and I got the surgery done in Vienna, because I had earlier two surgeries, they didn't work. My doctor said, you go to Vienna or Germany to get it done. I got it done there. And my doctor said, ki, you have to come back to see me after 3 weeks. I didn't know where to go. Fortunately, Dr. Jyotirindra Jain was teaching at Harvard University. And I wrote to him whether I can come and spend some time with him. He said, why not, of course. So he had an apartment there and all. So he was doing his work. And I used to look around in the shoppings and the square, you know, the Harvard Square. And I used to pass the statue of Harvard every day. And I used to imagine why this man, who was an industrialist, who was an entrepreneur, whatever, could think of this kind of institution 380 years ago. And still that institution is growing and growing and doing better and better. Why this happened? There are hundreds of such examples in Europe and America and any other country where some institutions were established and they are running even better today. Cambridge, Oxford, not only educational but even any field, you know, even museums, you know, I mean, like that. Why it doesn't happen here? Maybe it is because of our philosophy of ekla janore. You know, agar insan jiya hai to marega, to kyon karna? Jaise pehle kabhi koi documentation, there were no documentation systems in our country. There were no kind of written history of our country. If you have to refer to Rajasthan, you have to talk to Colonel Todd's books, you know, refer to, you know, many books. Even about writing on art and culture, we have to refer to most of the foreign people, those who have written books and all that, and not many Indians. Why? Because, you know, we have never thought of training people. We have never thought of, creating a cadre, creating a caring cadre, creating a sahrdaya cadre, creating somebody who has got the administrative abilities. Because you see, primarily, it is not art which is, I took the initiative in 2000. I had this dream after seeing that Harvard and all that. Why it can't happen in India? That person was always biting me all the time. So I took an initiative for my foundation in 2000. I was funded in a small way by travel grants for Getty Foundation to think of an institute for arts institution or administering art institutions. And we named it as, in Europe it is called arts administration. When we discussed that, I think Kapilaji was there and she suggested that you are not managing art, you are managing an institution, which is true, because it can apply to any institution. It can be a library, it could be an archive, it could be a museum, it could be a gallery, it could be a theater, it could be anything where you need somebody who thinks of the academic aspect of it to ensure that the academic content of that institution is intact. At the same time, you have somebody, if you can combine both, it's possible, and I think it is possible. Why I am saying it? Because you see what happened, that if you are running an institution as one boss, if there is a system where there are two, that's different. But if there is one boss, that boss should also have at least 30-40% of the academics or 50% of academics or whatever you call it, but 50% has to be hardcore management skills. And that hardcore management skills, which were not necessary earlier, I would like to emphasize here, they were not necessary earlier, 30 years, 40 years, 50 years ago, or because the skills were very small. You are established an institution, and then there were a few people come, few people go, and you are happy with it, whether your family is doing it, or your friends are doing it, or whether your neighbors are doing it. But now the skills are high, it is an international scenario. Everything, the electronics, has made it impossible for one individual. So it has to be administrative setup. I'm giving an example. Dr. Sihare was a great imaginary and great kind of a thinking person in this field. He established an institute in the National Museum. We're talking a lot about museums. Now look at this. It's very interesting. He established the institution in National Museum primarily for this purpose, what we are talking today, after how many years?
20 years.
We are discussing that. He thought and did it. He established an institution in the museum. 3 departments, art history, museology, and conservation. And
about 30 students come out of it every year. Every year they train 30 people. That's a different matter story, that who is the faculty and what is the kind of training. That can be questioned. But at least it is there. And it is a shame for us no, it's not gone. It's still there. I've got four of them working with me in my institution because they don't find a job in the government system. The bureaucracy's greatest problem has been to let it go. They were supposed to be facilitators. They were supposed to be a catalyst. They were not supposed to be the bosses. They become bosses. ASI people feel that it is their ancestral property, and they will not. It is better not to allow anybody to get into the museum. Archaeological side of the museum. I'm sorry, I'm taking more time, but I'm a hands-on man, and because I've got so much in me, which I've seen. I went to Mexico, and I was invited because they wanted something to about the archaeology. I was in tech at the time, as the chairman of the chapter, and I went to Yucatan. And the officer somebody who was showing me around, was my escort person, was a archaeologist. And I asked him, and he said, there was a very imaginative prime minister 10 years ago, and he made some agreement with France and Italy to train six archaeologists every year, 6 or 10, whatever it is, 5 there, 5 there, something like that. And 2-year or 3-year courses, best quality courses. And those archaeologists, when they came back, they started developing archaeological sites wherever there was a possibility. And you will be surprised that Mexico, which 30 years ago or 40 years ago, used to talk about only Mayan culture of 1,000 years or 1,200 years, now they are talking about 1,200 BC. Because every site they dig, they find something which takes their history back by 200 years. And then what happens is this, the story begins here, that they manage their archaeological sites so well with the museum, with the guided tours, with the electronic this thing, that today, before coming here, I inquired from one of the cultural officers of Mexico. They say about 1 million tourists come to see only those archaeological sites. Now, these are the possibilities. For example, in Shekhavati, if we have professional people, if we know how to go about it, in Shekhavati alone, what is there in Shekhavati in the vicinity of 40-50 kilometers, we can bring 1 million tourists only to see that. Nobody thought of it. In fact, we have a tendency of taking the brick away, not to put the brick back. So it is therefore the whole this discussion, I only want to say, that we have to sit back, we have to, discussions won't take us anywhere. Because, for example, before this beginning, you know, I was talking to Jyotin, nobody who has to take a decision, a call, they are not interested. If you call the minister, he will take 15, 20 minutes of 1 hour, and then walk away and say, I have to go to meet the prime minister, and he will go. Secretaries also Mr. Jawahar Sarkar was a bit exception, but he also could not do much in 3 years except showing his that he can do it, and he was well meaning, but he was not able to do much because the system is so bad. Ghun lagi hai, uske upar kaise makan banayenge? So therefore, I personally, was one last suggestion, that we should have a training program, fresh training program. I'll tell you something. Archaeological, for example, Delhi Museum doesn't employ anybody from their own people, those whom they train. Nobody. It is not in the recruitment rules that you will employ them. Department of Archaeology ASI runs a archaeology institute also. I am told that 30% of admissions there are of the employees' sons and daughters, because they don't get any support. And then rest of the people are those. Because unless there's a job opportunity, when we did that deliberations on art administration, the finding was, unless there is an opportunity and unless there is a profit, unless you have an employment opportunity after you pass or read something, why should you read? If you know that after doing your archaeology or your museum study, you will get only 10,000 rupees, and if he does a BBA or MBA, he will get 50,000 or a lakh of rupees. Why should they do it? So therefore, we have to think deeply about it. It's not the question of breast beating or not the question of blaming each other, that who is responsible, whether bureaucrat or so-and-so or so-and-so. But I think there's a great possibility. I'm a very positive man. I'm an optimist always. I personally feel there's a great opportunity and nothing is lost if we can really put our heads together and not depend on the government. This country is running today in spite of the government, not because of them. Therefore, just leave if cultural sector leaves the government behind and say, go to hell, we don't need you, which is happening in many fields, in cultural field also, like visual arts. There were 1,000 galleries in India. They don't need the government support now. Now, this is the way out. Thank you very much.
I think we are doing in spite of all kinds of problems, and we can do still. I feel that the fundamental problem is a problem of cognitive colonialism. The kind of institutions we are talking about are all urban, and they are all under the umbrella of the government, mostly, or government supported, and they expect bonanza and donation from the government, or they have independent private resource. Now, this entire model has been borrowed from the West. We are domesticated into a Western discourse. The entire philosophy of museum as a small gas board of, you know, ornithology and mammalian objects and this object and that object is a mortician's gallery of objects rather than as a part of life is also borrowed. And similarly, the entire approach of towards arts as a means for entertainment would not utkantha vinodana, it is Brahma Saru Sahadra, as it is said. And as Kumarasamy is oft quoted, remark that an Indian artist is no special kind of man, but every man is a special kind of artist. So the man on the ground, he knows how to thatch his roof, how to decorate his floor, how to decorate his walls, and his life has a conjunction of beauty and utility, embellishment and necessity. So what has happened is that we are not talking about those institutions at all. There is a vast array of institutions still working on the ground. There are self-governance institutions, dispute resolution institutions, cultural institutions, there are Buddha Sahitya Sabhas, Sanskrit, Santal Sahitya Sabhas, all kinds of institutions are there and they are active like anything. And all that the government has to do, and as Om Prakash ji rightly put his hand on the, he hit the nail, that the government has to play a catalytic role. It doesn't have to play a direct, interventionist role. As far as the government plays an interventionist role, what it does is to promote a society of spectacle driven by consciousness industry. That's all we see in Delhi. It is a carnival, it is a festival. It is never, very rarely, work on the ground to advance the arts or to nourish them on the ground. A further problem is with the definition of the arts. Who says arts are arts per se? Arts have been decontextualized and textualized in museums and art galleries. Our arts are directly connected with our human and natural resource management strategies. I have been working on the ground in the field, additional chief city forest and all, and we promoted culture as additional chief city forest. When they were talking about cultural biodiversity, we said it is bicultural diversity. Therefore, we said, let us promote folklore medicine hospitals, let us package the arts, let us have them sold. It has to also have a market. Therefore, it is for the government to play that catalytic role. And then the day the Department of Culture was invented, culture was dead. Because culture is not a matter of department. Culture touches all departments of life. Who says there is not a culture of, water resource management, a culture of medicine? Everywhere there has been culture in this part of the world. But does culture department play a catalytic role with other departments? No, it only promotes festivals. And that's what is required of it. So, until and unless culture is seen as a constitutive of, rather than instrumental, in or a cosmetic aid to, international diplomacy, there is no hope for us. But this is not our definition. We have borrowed our definitions lock, stock and barrel from abroad. And So I have not seen the staff are impossible. I have seen that they have talents, and it is possible again to act as a catalytic role. Even with the same people, it is possible to do things. And but the basic problem is a desertion of the charter. Most of the institutions, they began with you see high falutin charters, and they deserted them very quickly. Read anybody's charter, and then you will see that all the right words are there. When I was invited to the National Museum of Mankind in Bhopal, it says salvage and Museum of Community. You see national integration. All the usual claptrap is there, but when you see the museum, it is a museum of cottages. And when you are talking about communities, the communities are visiting to demonstrations and for setting up huts. They are beautiful, no doubt, but that's not a museum of communities. So we had a small change in the action strategy. Let the museum visit the communities. Let not the communities visit the museum alone. Let's not only have ex situ display, let's have in situ revitalization. Let's not only do collection of objects, let's do recollection of ideas. And then said that, well, that's a desertion of charter. Then they examined it as, no, it is the charter yearly. So how do we do it? So we spread out all over the country and introduced about 100 initiatives, community co-directed participative initiatives. And we used to spend about 10% of the money, and 90% used to be contributed by the community, because they cherish their culture. They understand it. They do it better than us. And so all that was necessary was to just be with them and then act with them. So this redemptive pedagogy of museology and arts administration, in which we have a hegemonic model. So we are at the center, inhaling the perfume of everything, judging, combining, inducing, to arrive at the very system of things. We are all the Ernest Neddon. This is colonial, the administrators. I mean, we are in the center of things. So we are in the center of the cobweb. So this sense of, a kind of a master narrative. There are hundreds of, narratives on the ground, which have to be projected against this kind of an approach. So, in fact, even abroad people are doing it. And museums of stupidity, museums of malice, museums of childhood, museums of immigration, museums of work, even though they are conventional museums, they are at least, venturing into new territories. So, here also, there are about 1,500 to 2,000 museums. In the National Museum, I was trying to, work with them. The National Museum is not to only export exhibitions abroad. I am also chairing that committee somehow. And all I see is that exhibitions are going abroad. But they don't act in the role of the National Museum to hold hands with the other museums, just help them. They said that we don't need money. We need some extension. We need some education. We need some conservation. And that conservation is also not chemical conservation, not lab-based conservation. Communities know their conservation. What we need is ecological conservation, local structural conservation. ASI doesn't have a list of, the conservators. Though they are using them all the time, they are used as native informants. They are not used as people in their own right. So the conservation is also off the rails. Therefore, it is important that government reassumes its catalytic role. ASI, we are talking about ASI. Why we hung on the ASI? ASI protects only about 3,500 odd monuments and sites. The state governments, among them, protect about 6,000-8,000 more. The country has about 1 million monuments and sites, most of them being pulverized and destroyed day by day. Since rock art is not understood, and everything that is amenable to analysis is protected, that is not amenable to orderly analysis is not protected. So therefore, there are hundreds of thousands of rock art sites which are not protected. And the BRO, in spite of, out of lack of information, not out of any mischief, they're pulverizing the boulders, in all over Ladakh, and then putting them in the road. Only Bhimbetka is protected. Just an illustration. So all I'm trying to say is that it is possible, even within this system, if we reinvent our cognitive categories. Our cultural cartography is not political cartography. It has to be, mental cartography also. In our anthropology, all are equal, but some are more equal than others, even within this country. So when we look at the our rural sector, we also see it as a kind of it's a tribalization of the rural sector, the entire rural sector. When you look at the hills from the plains, the hills are tribalized. So it's a neo-colonial approach of museology and arts administration which has to be given up, before anything can be done. And the leadership is there, the people are there, and if we only want, you know, animate electronic fantasies and hyperlinked electronic texts, and a kind of a Epcot center, environmental prototype community of tomorrow, then you are far wrong. This is not what we need. We need arts institutions which enhance and sustain life, and that then they will be relevant. Because the arts institutions are not relevant, they're seen as irrelevant, they're seen as, you know, vestigial and osios. Therefore, they're not supported. The day the arts institutions promote development and act as instrumental in development, development not in the sense of, you know, growing crops and sowing seeds. But when Dr. Richaria, he had about 20,000 varieties of paddy, germplasm, in Raipur. And the germplasm is resting there, whereas the Chhattisgarh has been museumized. And only about 30 varieties have survived, which are high input intensive. Now, so the living museum of the country, which is being museumized every day, I mean, the arts administration has to look at it at them, and the exhibition should be heritage action instruments rather than instruments for passive contemplation. And once we revise our sites like that, we shall see that we shall get sympathy and able to change things. Thank you.
Well, that's it. All the four speakers have had their say. Now, if they have to say anything to each other, they're welcome. Otherwise, I'll open it to the house.
I just want to inquire that, you know, just as I'm a reasonably friendly person, and therefore I'm okay with academic community as well as bureaucrats as well as politics, because I feel that everybody has to exist and it's a question of coexistence. But one thing which I never be able to understand, people like you, for example, I'm not a literate person, I'm not interested, but I want to, as a curiosity, I want to ask, when you people are there in the annual, where you have been in the National Museum, you have been the ASI, you have been the Indira Gandhi National Center for Arts, you are now running an institution which is training people for museums and things like that, you are running that. How is it that the people, those who are in the institutions, as long as they are there, they are different, and after they are not there, some kind of a post-retirement wisdom comes into it, and people say, oh, it should be that. I mean, why it happens? It's just for people like me, ignorant people like us, is there any specific reason for that? Why this after post-graduation wisdom comes into people, those who have not been able to do much? Is it because the system is bad? Is it because you are not serious about it? Or is it because what were the impediments, what you could not do when you were there? I want to ask.
See, everywhere I did what was possible, so I would not like to list those initiatives and how those institutions have transformed. And they had to be transformed within the existing setup. We could not change the setup. We have to function within the democracy, and we have to function within its instruments. We cannot change them. So within those institutions, I found that as soon as one drew these boys and girls into partnership, it was possible to function. And then as soon as, you know, one supplemented the institutional resources by drawing the community into partnership, then so it was possible to function. So I can list 100 initiatives, I mean, which took place. There is no point in listing them.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I'm very Institutions
are categories, according to me. So what I was doing was to harness the institution to that role of catalysis. And it was able to do that. But there are institutions which are also bogged down, as you say, in the quagmire of, you know, bureaucratization. It's not possible. I mean, it took about 3 years, 7 months at the IGC to even to get the deputy trustee to provide it with funds. It was almost getting close. When I came there, it was about 3 crores in the deficit. And when I left, it was about 60 crores, including the government funds. But then it's not a question of funds. They were also functioning all over the country and the world. And it was not only servicing spectacles, they were having field initiatives. So that it is not a venue for discussing that.
Yeah.
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 Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah
Now it is open to the House if there are any questions or clarifications. And let's not get personal, okay?
So my question was just because
there are many bureaucrats who made a difference and there are many who didn't. So there are all kinds. I mean, it cannot be generalized. There are institutions which are lifted up when a particular person is there, and there are institutions which just refuse to be lifted up, whoever may be there. So there are various permutation combination. Yes, anybody?
I want to I've been listening to everything. Frankly, I'm more confused than when I came in.
So that's the idea. That's the idea.
At least we should get some direction. Because so many solutions are offered. But the present state of affairs in many ways is dismal. Now, we have to go to the cause of it. Why is it dismal? And I think personally that because we depend too much on government. And the government, as somebody said here, is not art conscious to that extent. And therefore, the net result is all bureaucracy. The other day I went to a function which was celebrating 25 years of its existence. And I was just wondering, talking to a person sitting next to me, that his member secretary, I don't know whether the person is involved in art, culture, or what has what she has done to be here as a member secretary. Except maybe administration, which is a part of it, but not entirely, particularly for such jobs. So I personally think that the government is everywhere and it is politicizing everything.
Well, you have a point there. Yes?
Mr. Krishna, we get the mic, please.
You know, I mean, I'm not a government servant, I haven't worked for government at all. But at the same time, what happens is I'm an independent painter. From time to time I've been asked by government to assist, give my opinions, etc., etc. It's happened, it depends. I mean, I was on, for instance, I'll give you a very small example. I was on a purchasing committee, I was heading the purchasing committee of the National Gallery of Modern Art. And it was a pretty sleepy outfit at the beginning. But I didn't want to take any part in the sleeping part of it. But so when I suggested that if works have to be seen and not be summoned to the gallery every year, when people send, you know, new newspaper reports, notices go out and people are supposed to send their works, and works would naturally come in by the dozen, by hundreds, you know, and then the committee sits like in great judgment on these works and for about 2 days or 3 days or whatever, and then selects what it wants to buy, and the rest just stays around, and then the people are supposed to come and collect their work, which they didn't. A lot of work was just left there, you know, to be picked up or whatever. Anyway, what I suggested was, I said this is a very wrong method of selection, and what you need to do is really go around the country, see as much work as is possible. But it's 100%, it's a whole time job looking at going to meeting artists, going to their studios, getting them to put things together so that you can see, for instance, in Baroda, it's not possible to see every possible artist. You know. But we went all the way from Kashmir, right down south, and across, and we picked work. And this finally came through, and it was a pretty good selection, if I may say so. Now, the other thing was that it was between us, between the committee itself, and there was, of course, the National Gallery director, who was a member of the committee, and the government, and from the department, there was a person. However, since I was the chairman, I exercised my right to pick work which I thought was important. And I remember telling Tayyip when he did his very large triptych, I said, well, I think, you know, this should go to the NGMA, and so don't sell it. And he said, okay, but he did sell it. And he sold it because his daughter was getting married. However, I was in Bombay, I said, who do you sell it to? And they said, well, the gallery has got Gallery 7. So I went to see this chap. I said, listen, this is what happened. And we need this painting, it really belongs to people, and to you it will go into one private collection or something like that. So he said, I agree with you, you can have it. Just give me 7.5% more, which was the sales tax or the purchase tax that you had to pay. And so the painting came. But I hadn't consulted the committee at all. I had the painting sent, it came to Delhi, and I had it opened up, and I told them the story, I told the whole lot. So this is what happened, I think it should go in, and I think you should have the first refusal on this painting. And if you don't like it, we'll see what to do. I might buy it myself or something, you see. But they said they were very keen on acquiring it. And it's been there, and you know, Ramu wrote about this whole book on this subject, and so on and so forth. And what I'm saying is that the personal initiatives do count. And there are methods of getting over. You can run into trouble, of course. But then I think you can also pacify people because you're being reasonable. You're not doing anything for your own personal self. So I've had to do this a number of times. But it also fails, you know. I've been associated with the monument for Gandhiji. And it's taken, 7-8 years or something so far? 7 years maybe? It's a whole pile of papers there, but no chairmans have changed, committees have changed, and all the rest. And I tell them, I said, please realize that no work of art comes out of a committee. It comes out of a personal vision. And it's up to the Rastapati that you establish. He can surround himself with the appropriate people who will tell him what to do and so on and so forth. And then something might result. But no, it's now being handled by some MIT or one of these institutions, which is a sort of artistic and engineering-minded and all that sort of thing. And I'm nothing to do with it. And I said, you know, I just can't function that way. And it has to be left to go. I mean, I've done 3 or 4 large, very large commissions. And on each occasion, I was just left to my own resources, and there was no interference whatsoever. And it didn't mean that I did the whole thing myself. There were a number of people who helped me and who were involved. But I think that, I think it's been said, and I agree with it very largely, that the general atmosphere is, I'm surprised that it doesn't happen here. That there's shows of kids from schools used to visit the exhibitions and so on, taken by with arrangements with the gallery. And you have somebody explaining to them, chatting with them, and so on. And this is on a kind of a very regular basis. You know. And then you have a whole generation growing up to sort of appreciating pictures. Now, I'm not saying that appreciating pictures is the only bit of art or only bit of culture that there is. It's only it's a fragment actually. It's very small. And as Mr. Chakraborty was pointing out, there are much larger issues which are involved here. Well, I mean, you know, it's not one man's band, and it's the whole country involved with this thing, and people just have, I think the education system has to be geared up to be able to think in anti-colonial or non-colonial fashions. To do that. But in the meantime, I mean, we have been painting, we do want people to look at our work, and there should, a fortunate thing is that over the last 30 years, I would say, there have been these institutions both in Benares, in Baroda, in Bombay, and in Chennai. They have produced people who are specialists, who curate, who know what curating means, who have a knowledge of the history of art, you know, and of Indian art also. I'm not saying history of art meaning European art, you know, but they're very, very, very well steeped in our traditions and so forth. And I think they're doing a commendable job. And we've got a museum come up here in Delhi, And this lady who's curating it, she's a very well thought of person and very well educated in this piece. And they're very active. They're extremely active. Now, one museum is doing it, and many other things can be done for it. I mean, what happened with Swaminathan, for instance, in the Indian, in which I was associated very closely. He put up a museum. He had odds to fight, but we had you as our buffer. you gave it a name. I think it's this kind of liaison that actually creates institutions and even propagates them, and even sort of the continuity is maintained in that kind of way. I just feel very sad that Bhopal, what has happened to Bhopal is very, very sad. I mean, nothing is happening.
Any other comments? Yes, Sadhana?
Complex and huge area, and it's axiomatic that wherever the state gets into the arts get into a state. And we need not worry too much about it. But for me, the issue is simply this. You take the post-independence history of our engagement with the arts, let's say the state's engagement with the arts sector. There was a mandate there, and the mandate was connected to the national movement, it was connected to the socialist principles under which the constitution was constructed and so on. The mandate was simply this, that the state will be a buffer between a community that necessarily cannot stand for itself, the art community, that it needs support, it needs the word that Kishan uses, it needs buffering, it needs somebody who will have a kind of protectionist arm around it. And the state's job was then not to create segments like elite art, high art, low art, and all that. KK has really put his finger on it. But it was to see that art would be accessible, and that art would be democratized. Art practice wouldn't be an elite activity. Now, this is the loss that seems to have happened in the last, one would say, roughly 20 years, which is a post-liberalization phenomenon, as far as I'm concerned, where there is some sort of a deliberate design in the way art is being pushed into to the mercy of the market.
Yeah.
And I'll call it the mercy of the market, meaning for some people it's very good. Some of the best artists in the country are enjoying a new season, a blooming season because of the market coming to them. But for a large number, for art institutions, for colleges of arts, for departments of art, for galleries, for normal urban exchange or rural exchange in the art sector, it's a major disaster. And what is now coming in the last 5 years is a completely new mechanism about which we are not even talking nowadays, which is this thing called the creative and culture industries, where you are determining the value of art, what Jyotirindra Jain says, as a commodity in the market.
Yeah.
And that's all it will be, everything will vanish. If the Bastar jungle bronze does not sell in the market, so be it, let it die, is the principle, is the kind of unstated principle that we are embracing through the parliament. And that is what is shocking me, that it's coming through the parliament. So the exit of the state from the art sector is, I don't think it's chancy, I don't think it's accidental, I don't think it's because people are incompetent or not concerned. It's a very, very deliberate move that is happening, and that is where my fear factor begins, that if it's going to be that aggressive and that deliberate, then should not there be a counter thrust from the art community? Should it just lie back and take it and say that, well, we are going to perish and this would, the government is going out of it and so be it kind of thing? Or should we not say, let the government be accountable? I mean, Ashok said it in his opening thing, let it be accountable. You cannot run away, you cannot escape that mandate. After all, you're dealing with a ministry that has something like over 300-400 crores that's investing. It can't be ad hoc, it can't be meaningless, it has to be put to work. As far as I'm concerned, the institutions, whether they are the academies, whether they are the IGNCAs, whether the NGMAs, these are mechanical donkeys. They don't need vision. Vision has to come from somewhere else. It has to come from policy, it has to come from a larger frame. The institutions are donkeys that will be made to work. A bus that is driving from Karol Bagh to Connaught Place does not need visioning. All it needs is a direction. Start from here, go there, but work efficiently. Don't stop on the way. Don't belch, noxious, whatever. But work. We are going to put them to work. And this is where I think the government is reneging on its pledge. I believe the pledge was there. I believe when Maulana Azad made his first comment when the academies began, there was a pledge there. And that pledge has been lost somewhere. And this is what needs to be recovered. How the recovery will happen? I don't think it can happen without more committed action from the community work. If at all there's a community like that. And the problem is that community has vanished.
That's the art, and that's why the whole thing is flourishing. Yes. All other areas, there are organized forums, there are activists and things. Here, yes. I think there's no such thing. So, I think this would go on.
I have a reaction too. Can I react?
Yes.
Well, my illustration, for instance, I mean, the ASI has set up this Monuments Antiquities Mission. It has got a 14-point charter. Now, I've been talking to them several times. I mean, not in my personal capacity, because I don't have any official niche there. To fulfill, they're only pursuing one point charter, which is documentation. So they're repeating the documentation, which has already been done well at the different states, and duplicating the archives. They have a 13 more points, which they have not touched for the last 3-4 years. And one of the main points is capacity building. Capacity building of all the local bodies, I mean, for this purpose, for looking after their own, for conserving their own. Now, the charters are all there, as I said. I mean, the IGNC also talks about the courts, the Indira Gandhiji, that it is with the fragmentation of human beings in all kinds of roles, so you want to restore human autonomy. Similarly, IGNMS has its own charter. But the charters are only meant as, what should I say, empty shibboleths, as words. So, unless you see, as you say, the community holds them to their tasks, they deserve the tasks and not punished. They're not, because nobody is bothered. Nobody, the government money is not public money. That is the perception. Government money somehow is a kind of an arcane thing, which doesn't belong to the people. So it can be wasted.
Well, one thing that emerges is that can we think of working as a think tank on arts, a think tank in terms of, like you being said, a part of the civil society, a civil group, who tries to raise these issues.
No, but when it's a pressure group,
then it requires affirmative action from the civil society.
Mm. Yeah.
The 33% will be the advocacy for the cause. Heritage preservation, 33%. 33% will be public awareness, like making public aware about the same their property. And 33% was said that it will be like a project based, and which was, that was also as a pilots, not like a, that you get into this. But in course of time, what has happened is that intact has more or less 90% of projects and make money all the way and down the line, and all the advocacy and all the awareness and everything is gone. Therefore, I think that, as Sada has rightly said, this pressure of economic pressure of the freedom of and everything is connected with money and everything connected with profit. I mean, therefore, the non-profit organizations, so-called NGOs and not-for-profit organizations, are also looking at that as one of the way of survival, and not like the way they were established for.
Well, would somebody like to have the last word? There is anybody? Otherwise, I thank you very much for this evening. We have traveled a long path. Many suggestions are there. Let's see what can happen. at least the voice has been raised. At least voices have been raised. Thank you very much. The next one, what is the date?
18th.
December?
Yeah.
18th of December, Imagining Our Times. We have yet to fix up the speakers, but this will be the theme. 18th of December. Thank you very much.